look into the private sector's efforts to boost the country's vaccination drive. Joining us is Meredith Ngo, the CFO of MedGrocer. Meredith, good morning. Thank you so much for joining us. I know you're very busy.
Good morning, Mimi. Thanks for inviting us.
Okay. So, Meredith, I know that MedGrocer is sort of leading vaccination efforts for the private sector, including the administration of over a million doses of Sinovac brought in by the Federation of Filipino-Chinese Chamber of Commerce. I know it's been like a pool with so many groups dipping into that supply of jabs, like schools, social civic groups, but how's the situation on the ground been 3 weeks in? How many jabs have you administered? Would you say you're on track? What's the timeline?
Okay, as you can imagine, we just started, so the situation is evolving rapidly. For the last information, yesterday we vaccinated 3,000 doses across 3 sites. We're opening and expanding sites every week and can vaccinate 11,000 a day across 5 sites by the end of next week. In addition, we are also handling the HSPs across NCR, including hospitals and other mega vaccination sites by other HSPs. We do the coordination with them. Besides the shortage of the actual vaccines, our biggest challenge now is a very diverse range of expectations we have to meet. So some people want a comfortable place and the least waiting time to get jabbed, but some people want to get jabbed at the earliest possible date. So the best example might be the two very different approaches to signing up and waiting and scheduling vaccinations. On one hand, we have some HSP providers who go all out on tech. And on the other hand, we have those that go almost totally manual. Both of these have pros and cons. With technology being more efficient, but prone to system failures and customers' unfamiliarity. And manual processes being more flexible, but prone to inaccuracies. Our approach here has been to find the right balance somewhere between these two extremes. We still have a lot to learn. It's a very steep learning curve, but I think we're on the right track.
Mm-hmm. Meredith, I want to go back to the numbers that you shared earlier. You did say that yesterday, for example, you administered 3,000 doses across 3 sites. So on average, that's about 1,000 doses per site. And would you say this is, you know, the slow start? And eventually the number of doses administered per site per day will increase. What's the maximum that you're looking at?
Oh, the trajectory is very steep because of the people's because doctors and nurses get better at what they do all the time. Mm. So with what we can do in the first week compared to the third week is really, really vastly different. On the third week alone, it's already tripled the capacity of the first week. So the doctors and nurses get really, really better at what they do. Mm-hmm. A medical team now in our third week can double or triple their output compared to the first week. So we foresee that from the first week all the way to the 6th week, which we are projecting where we will be finishing at least for the NCR portion of the Sinovac vaccines, we will be able to reach this because this is a very exponential growth in capacity and capability every week.
Meredith, you know, this is something we've been hearing from organizers. Their problem is there seem to be not enough doctors and nurses. Is this true? I mean, it's one thing that we ramp up the capacity because they get better. So instead of doing just 1,000 per day, they're able to boost double or triple, as you mentioned. But there comes a point when it plateaus, when it peaks and then it plateaus. That is the maximum. And we've heard of news of, you know, doctors or nurses injecting, but not really pushing the vaccine in, just injecting and, you know, not. So we have seen those reports and some are saying it's the doctors are just too tired. It's over fatigue. They feel so overextended. What do you say to that?
I think it's just a matter of having the right support system to support the medical staff. It's true that the medical staff are really the frontliners and at the forefront of getting the vaccinations done. But a team of even the most amazing medical staff will not be able to perform as well as a team which is supported by a very good group of coders, customer service reps, and program managers. With the right systems, training, and teamwork, this medical team would be 3 times better than the output of another team without the same support. It's really about the support system.
Mm-hmm. Meredith, could you give us an idea of the scale of your operations? I mean, for one vaccination site, for example, how many persons, how many doctors and nurses are supposed to man that site? How many can they accommodate? And could you give us the numbers there in the operational side?
Our biggest vaccination site right now is our first vaccination site, which is Xavier School. For Xavier School, this is a 4,000 square meter space that we're using for the high school gym. But Xavier, thankfully, we're very, very grateful to Father Ari, has provided also the rest of Xavier School for us to vaccinate. So if we can have the clients who would actually vaccinate at Xavier, we can, in fact, do the 10 to 11,000 a day across the entire Xavier School.
Oh, wow. Okay. And how big is the team of doctors and nurses in Xavier School?
Right now, we have a team of 50 medical staff just in Xavier School alone, which has the capacity to do about 2,000 to 4,000. So you can imagine that we just have to, which is 200 medical staff, which is what we have right now for all 5 sites. We can actually put everybody in this 200 in Xavier School, and we can also vaccinate the same capacity.
Yeah, we've been monitoring because Xavier School, the Alumni Association, is also launching their own vaccination drive. We heard there were going to be delays, but this is not on the MedGrocer part because you guys are just administering the shots, right? It's from the supplier side. So we're waiting for word on that. Are you experiencing challenges with spoilage?
Oh, the nice thing with Sinovac is the actual expiration of the vaccines as labeled in the box is actually 4 years.
Oh, okay. Okay, and it's not very strict when it comes to temperature requirements, right?
Yes, yes. Although we are planning to use them up within a year.
So Meredith, this is essentially like a dry run for you guys. The first batch is to trickle in before the big bulk actually arrive for the rest of the population outside of the metro. From what you've seen, and you briefly talked about this earlier, the challenges of, you know, having so many expectations to meet, how do you think can we better handle the administration of the jabs? What kind of assistance, for example, can government give you guys to make it easier and more seamless and to make it faster? Because this is a race to vaccinate as many people as we can, as quickly as we can.
I think the issue here in the Philippines right now is unlike other countries who actually have even more resources than we do, we have a lot of restrictions and rules and regulations that the DOH has been imposing lately. We do understand that this is the first time for everyone, so it's better to be safe than sorry. So we are hoping that these regulations, for example, for establishing a vaccination site, which has a certain minimum requirement, a minimum number of doctors and nurses, and many steps from step one of registration to screening to vaccination to a 15-minute post-monitoring, and the minimum number of people that have to be present. We are hoping that as we move along and as people get better, as the medical staff and the admins get better, the government can actually ease the restrictions on these. And it will eventually, as the vaccines become truly approved and not just be under an EUA, that these can be treated like normal flu vaccinations, pneumonia vaccinations, or the vaccinations of other countries like the U.S., where people can just walk in and just be jabbed without this entire process of having to apply with the LGU for a Bakuna Center number, having it approved, doing a simulation, having all the medical staff interviewed. These would really, really hasten the process.
So Meredith, right now you're more focused on vaccination sites in Metro Manila, but I know that you have already gotten contracts for upcoming batches that are about to arrive, including for provinces and remote areas. Are you ready for that?
We're actually going to focus on NCR first and then NCR plus. We realize it is a steep learning curve, but the steep learning curve is really best if it's really supported by our HQ. And we realize our own limits as well. And the best is for us to be able to closely monitor them within the NCR plus area.
Meredith, for those who are wondering, we've always referred to MedGrocer as one of the units under AC Health of the Ayala Group, but apparently they're no longer investors of MedGrocer. They're going at it on their own, right?
Yes, that's true. We bought back our shares last year from AC Health.
Final question, and I wanted to end with this. Of course, you've got front row seat to what really happens in the vaccination process, from the arrival or delays in supplies to the administration of the jabs, from end to end. From what you know, from what you're seeing on the ground, do you think it's possible that we will hit herd immunity by the end of this year?
I think the bigger problem with the herd immunity by the end of this year is really the getting the mass market to actually accept the vaccinations.
Yeah.
So far, from what we've seen so far, the private sector is really helping the government step it up, especially when it comes to vaccinating the employees. So when it comes to employees who are actually with employers and businesses medium and up, I don't think we'll have a problem with that because the take-up rate is already growing. However, for the market that we usually don't see, for the undocumented market, for example, the sari-sari stores or the tricycle drivers, like for example, even my yaya's family, there is still a lot of hesitation on getting the vaccines. They're all in a wait and see period because of all these false news, fake news that's been going around. But I do think that they can get there, but maybe next year to really get the real mass population, the rest of the population to actually also get vaccinated.
I have heard of the same stories. Some people from the province are worried that when they get vaccinated, they're going to turn into zombies. I've heard of some people saying, you know, my neighbor got vaccinated last week, 2 days after my neighbor died, and they connect immediately the death to the vaccine when there are many possible reasons for the death. So really, it's going to be an information drive. And Meredith, thank you so much for joining us this morning for the insights and good luck. We're all counting on groups like you guys to make the herd immunity possible. Thank you for joining us this morning and keep safe.
Thank you. Thank you, Mimi.